Hi. Hello there. How you doing? Glad you made it. In case you weren't here, or in case you missed it, this is just a quick clip of something you might have missed last week.
Mister, get this thing off of me!
Oh, that would be gross cooking on a bug zapper. I don't care, I'm eating it anyway.
You know that Mr. Lady? I think I just killed her.
And now that that's out of the way, this is what's coming up on this episode of Real Garbage.
It's coming right for us!
I hand dig my own graves myself!
Just ask her for the tray. Point the gun in her face and go, give me the tray. And she'll be like, what? Here's the tray.
Yeah.
Burger's really good.
Woo! It's going to be a good one. So stick around. Here's a quick word from our fake sponsors before we get started.
This episode of Real Garbage is brought to you by the fastest January in human history. What the hell?
This episode is also brought to you by coffee. I miss it.
Bagel, bagel, bagel tear. Put it in reverse, tear. Put it in reverse. Oh, Lord. Lord, Jesus. Oh, Lord. Oh, Jesus. What you doing, tear? Tear, what you doing?
Real Garbage.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
did you quit coffee?
I didn't outright quit it, but I'm trying to ingest less of it.
You just didn't bring a 4-shot cold
I know.
Coffee recently.
I know. Well, that was mostly because I'm cold right now. So, and I didn't have time to stop and get a coffee. I thought about it, but I brought a blanket instead. Mm. But yeah, I've been trying to decrease my caffeine intake because throughout both my jobs, I'm constantly like on the go. So I have really small periods to eat. So throughout the day, it's just massive caffeine consumption followed by little increments of food, like multiple times a day. So I'm very like vibrating.
So wait, you're vibrating now with lack of coffee?
I'm maybe
so going through coffee withdrawals.
Yeah, not so much. I'm just like tired. I feel more.
See, okay. Here's a question for you. Do you hit the snooze bar in the morning? Are you a snooze bar person?
Not at all.
That's good.
I don't think I've ever hit the snooze button in my life, except when it's like my day off and I set an alarm for a certain time and then I'll wake up, but I won't spring into action because I don't have to work that day. So I'll just slowly, you know, just shake off the sleep. I'll slowly get into my day. But if I'm working, the alarm goes off at 8, 9, or 10 and I'm immediately up and in the bathroom and like doing my shit.
I can sometimes be a no snooze bar person, but I have been a snooze bar person and you're just saying you're tired. So I was just wondering because if you hit a snooze bar and go back to sleep, your body's like, oh, we'll go back to sleep.
Yeah.
Sleep.
And then 9 minutes later, you're like, ah, like that whole time.
9 minutes.
Isn't that the
5 minutes?
Oh, I'm talking like the standard snooze is like 9.
What's standard?
I don't know.
I have an alarm at 6 and an alarm at 6:02. I always have them 2 minutes apart. So this one goes off like snooze and I can't get right back to sleep before it goes off again. So I usually get up after that. I do that about 3 times.
See, I think maybe that's why I can't do the snooze thing because I 100% can force myself to go back to sleep.
Consciously, you're like,
yeah,
go back to sleep.
Yep, that has never been a problem for me. Yeah. It's been very successful if I've taken any road trips. I'm just in the back and I'm bored and I don't know what else to do. I'm like, yeah, I'll go to sleep and then I'll just force myself to go to sleep.
What?
It's actually...
Must be nice.
Yeah. It's really bad. This week I had a day off, which is really nice. And it was... That overcast, or not this week, because it's only Tuesday, last week, when
it's been overcast every single day.
That's true. When it was really overcast and dark, I always on days off.
Any day. In the last month.
Yeah. I always on days off have my alarm set for 10. I'm like, that's the max I'll sleep in.
Jesus, 10 o'clock.
I treat myself.
Force myself to sleep till 10.
Oh, but it gets, so I had my day off and my alarm went off. And I knew consciously it was 10, But I opened my eyes and it was so, so dark. And I was like, I don't have anything to do today. You know, I'll just power nap, go back. And I opened my eyes and it was 12:30. And I was like, okay, that happened. And then I thought to myself, I was like, I could keep going.
Might as well just go back to sleep.
Yeah.
Day's half over anyway.
I was like, I could like just shut my eyes and lie there and like force myself back to sleep and like do it all over again. So that is not an issue.
Okay. Why did this conversation start? Oh, coffee.
Coffee. Yeah. Coffee. I think I only had one cup of coffee today, and it was a regular brew, like, coffee cup.
I'm pissed. I can't find... So my buddy Tyler has this issue all the time. He can't find white chocolate bars.
Oh, yeah.
White chocolate mocha. Why? Who is out there? I might have said this on the last episode. Who the hell is out there buying all the white chocolate bars? Is everybody making white chocolate mochas now?
I thought white chocolate was seasonal.
No, it is all the time.
Really?
It's just like you go into any grocery store right now. Huh. Not any grocery store, but you go to Walmart, for example. Look, white chocolate, empty. All the other chocolate, Lindor. It has to be Lindor. You can't make a white chocolate mocha without Lindor white chocolate. What do you mean no?
No, I'm saying no, I agree.
Oh, okay. I'm like, what the fuck? No.
You're like, are you kidding?
It has to be Lindor.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Because every other one doesn't work, apparently. And just it's chalky. Doesn't taste as good.
No.
But I can't. I made one half sweet white chocolate mocha this weekend and then went to get some chocolate and was like, what the hell? So I need to start stocking up.
Yeah.
So I got to order a bunch of paint stuff because I was painting in here. So we did the white walls, but then I just got artsy on the weekend and I did some paint pouring videos. I'm just hooked on them now. And I moved everything off the floor after everything had dried and realized that I got three or five giant splotches of green paint on the carpet. Looks like I murdered a leprechaun on the living room floor.
No.
Yeah, so I got like an idiot. I'm like, it's acrylic. It should just come off with a wet rag. I just rubbed it in more, and then I got OxyClean, and then I've got it half cleaned. It's, man. I'm not moving out of here for a while, so. Yeah.
Can't you bleach it?
It is apartment carpet. I don't really care.
Yeah.
I'll just walk all over it for the next year or two until it just becomes part of the carpet.
Yeah.
It's just it was like that when I got here.
Naturally disperse
like Bart Simpson. It was like that when I got here. Okay. You'd never seen a Steven Seagal movie.
No, I've never seen a Steven Seagal movie. I always thought that Steven Seagal was Katie Seagal's husband. Because I knew her as an actress from Married with Children and Leela's voice from Futurama. So.
Spelled his has an extra A.
I know, like Seagull.
Seagull.
Seagull. Seagull.
Steven Seagal. I figured it out watching this movie. He is fat Mark Wahlberg. It's the way he talks.
Yeah.
Like this. Everything's all up here. He's like,
yeah,
it's almost
he was
like
always
he's
whispering.
He's out of breath when he starts talking. Like he exhales and then goes, the fastest January ever. Fastest January in human history. It went by way faster. That's just how it's the strangest thing. I hadn't seen a Steven Seagal movie in a better part of two decades.
Oh, wow.
And I decided we were going to watch The Foreigner.
Yeah.
Not to be
confused with
Jackie Chan's movie, The Foreigner.
Yeah.
2013?
2017.
Yes, that's right.
Trying to find this movie's Wikipedia was so hard because if you type in The Foreigner, everything that comes up is the 2017 movie.
You just got to put 2003 behind it.
Yeah.
Because this got 0% on Rotten Tomatoes. I was trying to find one of his older movies because they're actually like half decent. Like they got 4.5 out of 10. This got like a 2 out of 10 or less.
Deserved.
Yes. I'm going to try
yeah.
to tell people what
try
this is
and
about.
Nutshell it.
So The Foreigner, 2003, Steven Seagal, is a movie about a man who has a special set of skills. He's ex-CIA, I think. And he gets hired to do a job, does the job, almost gets killed, then like quits, and then flies to Berlin to go to his dad's funeral. And then he eventually gets tied up with some French dude. I don't even know. Don't know.
There was no concrete plot. There was no concrete, okay, this is what's going to happen. Then this,
The only thing was get the package.
Yeah.
Get the package, deliver the package. I don't know how many times they said the package.
I know. Like, stop talking about your package. What package?
I was going to start doing a count, but I got to about 20 minutes in. And I was like, okay, I've heard the package about 15 times. That's good. Then you didn't hear it for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just kind of just salted in there. Yeah. Like, oh yeah, there it is. There it is. There it is.
There's the package. There it is.
So this movie starts off, man,
just right
in Poland.
Yeah.
We start off in Poland. We're introduced to what's his name? Olifant.
Oh,
Jared,
yeah.
Jared Olifant and this other dude who I don't even know how this started again.
I know.
He's having a smoke. He's fake smoking. There's a lot of close-up shots in this movie.
Yeah.
A lot of it's really artsy. Trying to be artsy,
yeah,
but it's
it
not.
Was like like this was the camera the whole time, back and forth.
I'm gonna add some of that into this.
Yeah,
if I burp, I was thinking about it. If I had one good burp, like, burp. Okay, so let me try to remember this.
Yeah,
start off Olifant, let's just call him the two bad white guys.
Yeah,
the one guy's like, meet me over here, and he meets him. I have to remark on how he was standing,
how he was walking, and he was like walking backwards, and then
look, he looked so nervous. I actually wrote down why.
Yeah.
Oh, the music. He could hear the music. The music was so intense, like dun 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 dun, bum 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 bum. Like credits are rolling, and he's walking backwards like he's freaked out.
I
and
know.
Then all of a sudden it's like an SUV just rolls up and he's like, oh hey, what's going on?
Yeah. So like the first disappointing anticlimactic moment,
the guy gets out, he's like, this better be worth it. And the dialogue, the writing was so, it was just like
stiff.
I had a word for it. Very vague. It was very vague, because they're just like, you gotta get the package for me. All right, I'll get the package. Where's the package? Here are the coordinates. Cool, on my way to get the package.
Yeah. What's the package?
Hire a professional. Is that where he says that?
Yeah, pretty much.
Both remark. Oh, they also both talked about how cold it was.
Oh, yeah. They're in Warsaw, Poland. Of course it is.
It's too cold for ice, but yet neither of them are wearing a scarf.
I know. They're not even like bundled up.
Their ears are exposed. They're like, oh, it's so cold out here. I'm like, doesn't look that cold, boys.
Yeah.
You're liars. Though this is where it is. So we instantly cut to a torture scene.
I know.
We go from outside, cold, we got to find the package, to
burning some guys with a lit cigarette.
Okay, thinking back, was that, wasn't, who was doing
that
the torture?
That was Doobie Doobie Doo.
Was it Dunois? Dunois. Or O-I-R, depending on who the captioner was.
Yeah.
Dunois.
Okay, I called him Doobie.
At one point, Steven Seagal wrote down his name. I had to literally pause that and go, the hell does it say? Dunois? Dunois? Like it was O-I-R. His writing was terrible. Knows the assailant? I'm like,
Dunois.
Dunois knows the assailant. I'm like, all right, okay. So they torture this guy, and he's like, the package, again.
Yeah.
The package is already delivered. You're too late. I'm like, oh my God.
Like, what is it? They were like amping up this package so much. And just when we find out what it is later on, I was like,
such a letdown.
Are you kidding?
Photos? Okay, photos, yeah. And a flight recorder. A flight recorder with, we'll get there later.
Yeah.
This had a $20 million budget. Just keep that in mind.
I know.
$20 million. This movie looked like it was shot by college students. I think half that budget went to Steven Seagal.
Honestly, I probably, because I haven't heard of any of these other actors he was acting with. It was just Steven Seagal and then all these other people. And I was thinking like, who? And I know it's not an age thing, because I will like watch movies from back then with like meh known actors. And I'm like, oh yeah, that guy, you know, but these people were absolute nobodies. Mm-hmm.
This was 2003 as well. Well, nobody wanted to be in this. Well,
I know why.
You read the script, you're like, no.
Yeah.
How many times are they going to say the package?
Absolutely not.
I don't want to be part of this. Nobody should want to be part of a Steven Seagal movie after 2000. After 96.
Yeah.
Like, come on. Like
after his prime.
His first four. Like Hard to Kill, Out for Justice. I think that was his first one. You just have, when you get a chance, just flip through IMDb and just click on all those movies and just read what his name is.
Is it John Cold?
Jonathan Cold. I saw that. I was like, oh, we have to watch this. His name is Cold.
And it's in Poland.
He'll have like, I can't think of any other ones. I should have wrote them down, but they're ridiculous. So we meet him. We're getting introduced to him, and he's classic Seagal. Like, of course, he's got to have some hot chick like suiting up after a night of sex. And he's like, oh, was it good for you, baby? All right.
Also, I, having been subjected to a couple of Van Damme movies now, I can understand why the women were, oh my God, he's so hot and head over heels. You know, if I were an actress in that time period and my agent was like, hey, you want to have a brief moment in a Van Damme movie and like be his arm candy? Hell yeah. Van Damme was hot. Steven Seagal, he couldn't pull her. Absolutely the hell not. Unless he had major clout, like walking around being like, I was the former CIA operative.
Well, he's deep. Like, he's Mr. Cobbler?
Weber.
Weber.
Yeah, like.
What was up with his hair? Was it?
I know.
Was it just slicked back? Was it long or was it short? Was it like a mullet? Because his hair never moved.
No, it was very gelled and coiffed to his head. It looked like Roblox or Lego where it just.
I wanted to see one of the strands at the front right, just move just to know if it was long all over or if it was, because it looked like a mullet.
It did. It looked like, you know whose hair looked better? John Travolta's in Maniac. The Fanatic. Ooh. His moose's little mullet hair. Moose. That looked better.
He goes and meets his boss, his Polish boss here, and he's like, I got one last job for you. I don't know if that's Polish. I've got one last job for you. You'll go pick a package for me and bring it back here, and I will let you go see your dead father.
And he's like, I'm retired.
I don't do jobs anymore.
And that's when he's like, what did you say?
And then he just gets tossed in the car with Du Noir. And I didn't realize, now I'm glad now that I know, I didn't realize it was Du Noir that was doing the torturing. I'm just like, who's this Billy Idol looking? Like, he sounded like, what did he sound like? I wrote down what his voice sounded like. Oh, like Jason Statham. Like
a little.
Just don't worry, we'll get there eventually. Yeah. Hey, how long we got to on this trip? We'll get there when we get there.
He literally says, we'll get there when the car stops. Yeah, that's okay.
Thanks, tips. Thanks, Frenchie.
Yeah, shut up, sassy little toad.
It almost seemed like, well, I didn't, like, you know, you don't find out until later why he's there. Mm-hmm. It was always set up. You realize that as soon as this happens.
Yeah, as soon as you see the guy from the beginning torturing someone and now he's on a mission with Seagal, you immediately know that he's a bad guy.
See, I didn't even put that together because, like I said, I didn't realize it was Du Noir. But I just mean after four dudes come in, kick down the door and shoot the place up.
Oh, yeah.
And it bursts into flames. A little bit of wine, which apparently is flammable wherever they are.
Well, I mean, it is Europe. So their alcohol, they take very seriously.
They're putting antifreeze in the wine.
De l'antifreeze dans le vin. Oh, mais c'est sérieux, ça.
They tips into the fire and just all of a sudden
eviscerates this whole place.
I guess that was like an IKEA easy burn house or something.
New from IKEA is the latest addition to our easy line of houses. Introducing the Flammenhausen. The most affordable home to date, the Flammenhausen comes complete with structural beams, light construction rope, and 47,000 individual strands of farm quality straw. Sure, it's highly flammable, but at least you won't be living in a mud hut anymore like those dirty dirt farmers down the road. Just make sure to keep your flammable wine away from your fire. In fact, you should probably keep the fire outside. This thing is made of straw. The Flammenhausen, new from IKEA. By structural beams, we mean dry kindling strips. Light construction rope actually means highly flammable bale twine. IKEA is not responsible if your Flammenhausen burns down or blows away. The Flammenhausen, from IKEA.
They're on sale. Buy two, get one free. Yeah, they get outside, and I'm like, what? So obviously, seems like somebody burned it.
Yeah.
While they were in there, it's just timed out perfectly with the fire starting wine.
Mm-hmm. After.
Hold on. There's a quick flashback here.
I was gonna say, was that a flashback? Because we see those idiots in the future.
Because you're talking like the club scene,
the techno rave fashion show.
Oh my God, that I
felt like I was watching Blade. I thought blood was going to start raining from the ceiling and everyone sucking on each other.
But that was just weird because they were just, why were they all just staring at each other?
I know. It was all very like,
I think I may have seen you there too. And he's like, flashes back to, for people that have not seen this movie, there's a scene where We cut back to a club scene. We get a strobe effect on the whole scene. Cut into a shot of Steven Seagal. Cut into a shot of Dumois. Cut into a shot of, like, people drinking. I thought it would have been funny if all of a sudden it was like we cut to some dude just like placing an order with the waitress, and then like it flashes back to him getting his burger, and it flashes back to Seagal's turn. The other guy comes back to this guy,
he's
tucking a napkin in his shirt,
just
greasy. Burger's really good. That's what they should have done with it.
I know. No, it was
just
so confusing.
Just back to them. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah. So does that mean, did Seagal just put it together that these two know each other? Apparently.
I guess. I didn't. No. I was still trying to piece together if it was a flashback or if they briefly were like, yeah, this just happened in the scene. Now we're back in there. Like,
it was all over the place. I wrote down at one point, this movie is all over the map because there is a lot going on, very minimal explanation, and you need to at that point, I'm still trying to figure out, because I think it's right after this, he goes and sits down with the boss and he's like, I'm out of here after this last job, slides a piece of paper over to him and it says, in very, very chicken scratch writing, Dunois knows the assailant.
Yeah.
And for the next 20 minutes, I'm like, who the hell is he talking about? Because I missed the connection of like the dude that kicked down the door with the gun looking at Dunois or something.
It was so weird. And then also, can we talk about the camera angle they decided to use in those meetings where it was head on for Seagal and then it was like, if this is the camera, it was shooting up at the other guy's face.
Everything was a close-up. Yeah. Because the $20 million budget, but they shot everything in close-up like Sharknado and all those other crappy movies.
Apparently, they shot this movie entirely in Poland, too. So maybe
that's probably where the money went.
Yeah. Why?
So he gets to go to his dad's funeral. And while he's at his funeral, where was the funeral?
Okay, so the funeral was in Poland, and I paid. Right. I had to rewind this because I was so confused. But the guy was literally saying, "This is so and so Jackson Cold's memorial. We're having a service here in Poland, the country that he loved defending so much, and then we're bringing his body to his home country, which you assume is America because Steven Seagal doesn't have an accent. And I'm just thinking, are they going to bury this guy in Poland and then dig him up and bring him back to America to be buried? Like, how are you having this? Because they're having a decorated funeral.
They're just burying him in Poland.
But then
he
literally
served in Poland. So he's bury me in Poland.
But the guy says in his exposition that he's going to be taken back to his homeland.
Oh, then they're probably just putting him in the ground for ceremonial purposes and then pulling him back up. They're not going to cover him in dirt.
Yeah. Well, but why dig the hole in the first place?
There's a job right there. What do you do for work? I dig graves back up.
Yeah.
But not for the reasons you think.
Yeah. Can you imagine clocking in for work and being like, okay, Greg, you're going to dig this grave, but we're not actually going to use it, okay? So you're going to have to refill it in half an hour. I'd be pissed.
They use machines. They don't dig it by hand.
Really?
Yeah, they use excavators. The hand-dug graves are a thing of the past. I was joking. Like, I'm not seriously thinking some dude's shoveling. Can you imagine that was your job? You're a literal grave digger not using machinery?
I thought it would just be an extra personal touch to keep the old
ways. I'm sure if you owned your own property and you own your own cemetery, you could be like, I hand dig my own graves myself. I will put your pappy in the ground. Don't you worry.
Oh, my God. I'm gonna put in my will, my grave must be hand dug. ultimate last fuck
you. Assign it to some person by law, says they have to dig it by hand. No shovel, just their hands.
Here's a garden hoe.
Do it. Dig my grave, you piece of garbage.
Oh, my God. And in her last will and testament.
So it's after the funeral. Is it the CIA guys that track them down?
I think. They're American, so I think
FIB,
so.
FBI, CIA, DEA.
MIB.
Yeah, they track them down and
they're having this important discussion on an escalator.
What's up with over the shoulder bro, like in Seagal's face?
I know.
The whole time. Like he even at one point, like when they introduce him, he just walks up into the frame and is like right next to Seagal's face while he's talking. I'm going, did this guy know he was supposed to do this? Did they just have one take? They're like, shit, he got too close. Just leave it.
Just leave it. And then Seagal just flips him over the escalator.
It's because Seagal's like, you know what? Screw you, pal. And the guy's like, watch your mouth. And then,
boom.
And just tosses him with one hand with his Aikido skills.
Yep.
Into the other escalator. Now, historically, you may have heard this. Steven Seagal is well known for treating his stuntmen like trash. He hurts people. So that dude probably, he didn't land on pillows. He landed on the other escalator.
Yeah.
He really threw him.
Because he was, I noticed that because I noticed him on the escalator just staying still, like riding up in the background when the CIA guy was like, let him go.
He might have been out cold for all we know. Seagal's mean.
Steven!
He would actually, because he's like, I want to make it look real.
Oh my God.
he's been known to hurt some people.
Holy.
So he meets up with his brother. They have a little chat.
Yeah, and Sean and John.
Very original Jackson.
Yeah.
They meet. Where are they? Are they at someone's apartment?
I don't know.
Is it his apartment? Because it's a pink room with two white chairs and a telephone, a rotary telephone.
I know.
And a one lamp.
Are they jumping back between France and Poland? I know that's really easy to do in Europe. You just hop a train and you're in another city in a couple hours. But, or a country? Yeah.
Could be.
But there was no definitive timeline about when this was happening, where it was just back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and you're left thinking, okay.
It was about this point, because this is crazy. This is only 28 minutes in.
Mm-hmm.
That's what blew me away the most. I hit the time and was like, you gotta be kidding me. We're only 28 minutes into an hour, 35 minute long movie?
Yeah.
Whoa. So now we're just all of a sudden we're back with Dunoir sitting in a cafe.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, your boss wants to come and he wants you to come and see him. He's like, can I just pay my bill, please? What's his accent? He's French. That's
he's
right.
Yeah. And then he shoots the waiter with a silencer. And then parkours up a wall. And then
that was very strange, that shot. I was like, was that him?
Yeah.
That was him. Okay.
And then he just goes on a killing spree.
Murders the maid.
For
no reason. It's just like, thank you, my dear.
Yeah.
Because he wanted the tray. Like, just ask her for the tray. Point the gun in her face and go, give me the tray. And she'll be like, what? Here's the tray.
Yeah, he was very liberal with murder, this doobie-doo-boo.
He murdered the two people in the cafe, and then he murders her. And then he walks in, has the meeting with his boss, murders his boss.
Yeah. And then
after he murders his boss,
he goes to the.
Oh, did you notice he's smoking in every single scene?
Yeah, it was in his contract.
I figured that he got that. He went to that ammo crate he had with guns at one point, and I'm like, it's just full of cigarettes. It's
mm-hmm.
all this. Opens it up.
Yeah,
no guns, just more packs of smokes. I'm good. So now he kills those guys. It's always smoking. All over the map. Oh, we meet Mr. Mims. Who I was calling Pharrell Williams or Prince or artist formerly known as Prince or a pimp. What was up with his outfit?
His little hat and his matching suit and stuff. He was so...
Is this guy an assassin?
Yeah, he was so slick, but what are you? A spy? A government operative?
A baby-faced assassin! They didn't really give any explanation of what he was. He was just meeting with Oliphant.
Yeah.
And Oliphant was telling him, hey, go get me the package. We still don't know what the package is.
Package.
Just go get me the package. I'm like, okay. This movie was trying to be Snatch, I realized halfway through. It was trying to be Snatch.
I know that's a Jason Statham movie, but I've never seen it.
It's from 2000. You need to watch Snatch. Wow. It's like the best Guy Ritchie movie ever.
Really?
It's up there. Hmm. Well, all Guy Ritchie movies are awesome, except for King Arthur. Most of Guy Ritchie movies are amazing. So, yeah, you need to watch Snatch.
Okay.
Oh, my goodness.
I just have to make a comment of Steven Seagal's little mini camera.
It looked like a Motorola Razr on its side.
It did!
Spy cam.
And then, so he goes back to his house and gets knocked out by this random guy. And we
just
see...
labeled as the stranger on Amazon Prime.
Yeah. And then I did like this scene, though, when he had him and he was choking him out. And it was a perspective shot of Steven Seagal. So it, his like vision was getting like partially clear, partially blurry because his oxygen was getting cut off. I did like that shot. I thought it was really cool.
The presentation from the stranger though was just, it was almost theatrical, over the top and unbelievable.
Oh yeah, it was very cartoon villainy.
You have to tell me where the package is.
Yeah.
Or else you're going to choke to death. Well, not choke. It was almost like almost an air of Bill Cosby there.
Ooh,
creepy.
A little bit. Very creepy. And then he smacks him with a chair, gets out of there. Like
He unties him. He unties him, takes him to the train station.
Right.
Because he says, I have the packages. So this is
right.
Here's another thing that Seagal did in this movie is he planted bombs
everywhere.
He planted two bombs, and this is the first of two bombs. He's the package is somewhere else. It's almost like he's like, at some point someone's gonna come looking for me. They're gonna get me in a bad position, and I'm gonna have to take them to this thing. So I'm gonna blow them up. He plants a bomb in the train station. Buddy opens it, opens package. You were talking about it, size of explosion versus package.
Yeah.
This thing was the size of a shoebox, even smaller than a shoebox.
And it blew up a train station.
Explosions coming out of every single window.
And Steven Seagal maybe had a 5-second head start jumping out of the window. There's no way he'd walk out of there like.
The flames were licking his heels as he jumped.
Yeah.
That was an impressive explosion. It was way too big, though.
God.
And then the next scene, he just cuts in. And now all of a sudden, he's just sneaking in somewhere.
I know.
So he has spoken with Van What's-Her-Face. Meredith Van something. Van Hatton.
Yeah.
I can't remember. Van Dyke? Van Kine? Van... Doesn't matter. Van it's written somewhere else. He's sneaking into her place. And these security guards... Okay, it's broad daylight. It's broad daylight, and this place looks like the freaking White House.
Yeah.
It's a bridge going in. He just like hops a fence, shimmies down the bridge, hops over, then pulls out his gun.
And then breaks into her bathroom.
Oh, hold on. He shoots five terrible henchmen.
Yeah.
Two of them walking by them like together.
Hey, I know.
How was your weekend, bro?
They have these huge guns. And Steven Seagal just has his handgun with a silencer. And he's like,
He's hiding in the trees, the row of trees.
Yeah.
Shoots two of them, and of course that techno music starts up again, and it's like super slow motion. And he hits them in the shoulders. Just the shoulder, not the head.
Yeah.
Like a trained operative would. Mm-hmm. Shoots them in the shoulders, and they don't make a sound.
Don't
shoot their gun. The third guy is like, like running in slow motion, and Steven Seagal just, pew, pew. And he like shoots two more guys. Yeah, and then he breaks into the bathroom. The ugliest big mansion bathroom I've ever seen.
I know. I have never understood how that is supposed to look posh or wealthy. You have this giant room and there's this small lion foot claw tub in the middle of it. Boring.
We almost forgot how he broke in with the old school. It's the same place he got the spy camera from. The suction cup. Circle cutter.
Yeah. From Acme off Looney Tunes. I swear to God.
The whole window falls in.
Yeah.
Oh, whoops. Who are we cutting to next? I said, why only silence one gun? Oh, yeah, because Dunois's got two guns.
And one is silenced.
Like, what are you trying to be heard? You trying to be quiet? What's your objective here?
Yeah.
This guy's just a murderer.
Yeah, he just loves, he's very liberal with the murder. And then finally.
Oh, he's going to look for Mr. Mims. Oh, he finds Mr. Mims.
Yes.
He's looking for Cold.
Yes. And then he shoots the lady at the front desk. He goes up. Mims finds him and is like, and I made a note. Finally, this parkour goblin is gone.
But
no.
What happened is he's a top tier hitman, we're led to believe. So is Mr. Mims. He gets the drop on Dunois and spends 5 seconds going, ha ha, got you, sucker. Pulls up the shotgun. Yeah. Like, it's a full 5 seconds. And what's Dunois doing? Like, oh no, he's behind me. Looking right at him.
Yeah.
Boom, gets shot.
And I guess.
Tuck and roll.
Yeah, and I guess Dunois had a bulletproof vest on.
Yes, a flak jacket.
Yeah.
Because I didn't catch, I was like, oh man, he got him.
Same.
And again, blew him out the window.
Yeah.
Like 30 feet out the window.
Yeah.
Mythbusters busted it. It can't be done. It doesn't happen. You hit up somebody with a rocket launcher, it might happen. but there'd just be pieces jumping out the window. So Mims kills him.
We think.
Yeah, we're led to believe that.
He's going to go look for this guy in a silver Volkswagen or something.
Because Mims gets a phone call, and it's like the boss, and he's like, well, how should I proceed? He goes, if you have to ask me that question, then you shouldn't be doing this. He's like, okay, hangs up, and he's like, all right, I got to find a silver Mercedes. Silver Mercedes pulls by him. He's like, well, there's the car I'm looking for. Same license plate and everything. And it turns out that Seagal had sold the car gave a guy $2,000 to drive it somewhere.
Yeah.
Like another thinking ahead, like he's super smart. This is what's going to happen. Someone's going to try and kill me driving the car. I'm like,
and
you wouldn't know that.
And then Mims just kills him. He's like, you dumb motherfucker.
He's mad. He's like, damn it. Boom. Let's kill this innocent person.
Yeah.
This is 2003. What year are we supposed to think this was?
Because at the beginning, he answers that little Nokia cell phone. But then this entire time, we see rotary phones. We don't see any, like, 2003-esque technology.
Maybe Poland is just way behind in technology. That's what I was thinking.
Maybe.
Who knows? So he opens the package. He's like, you're never supposed to open the package.
Yeah.
But I'm going to open the package.
I'm going to do it.
Cuts it open, and it's, pictures of a plane crash that was basically fired upon by these people doing illegal tests of weapons.
Yeah.
That's what we find out. And the Oliphant and the other dude are behind it all. I'm like, okay, those are some stakes, but it was very anticlimactic. And then he makes a CD bomb. It's just a CD disc, and he just goes, click. And puts it like what were supposed to be the CD, or just puts it on a counter. He leaves it there, but then later he has it on him.
I know.
He actually got it when he went to change his jacket.
Oh, I guess.
That's what it was. So now, Dubois is still alive. Yeah. He goes to his ammo crate, gets his smokes, and gets his guns and more bullets. And then he heads off to blah, blah, blah. So we find out he opens up the do not open flight recorder. The flight recorder, this is what I was going to say earlier. It's basically just the pilots going, oh no, what is that?
Yeah.
It's coming right for us.
Like, in no way does it say, oh, Mr. Oliphant's responsible for this.
That's a missile coming right for us. This is Oliphant Incorporated on the side. Oh my God, there's three of them.
Yeah, it's so weird.
Vague.
Yeah.
Vague. This is the word to describe this movie is just vague.
Yeah.
Like, what are we supposed to believe here?
And then, so Steven Seagal and Mims meet up at the beach and they had a fucking bitch fight. It looked like they were slapping each other. It didn't look like they were doing like, block, block. It looked like they were like,
was this
slapping each other?
This was way later though. Wait, after that, because he throws a disc at him first. Slow motion throw. Yeah.
And then he throws the disc at him and
here's the disc. And just frisbees it at him because he's a professional CD thrower.
Mm-hmm.
And blows him 40 feet into the water, even further than Dunois flew.
Yeah.
He meets up with her, gets all the information, gives her the package, or does he?
Yeah.
Gives her the package.
Yeah, he gives Meredith.
This movie uses so much slow motion. He even exited. He's like, make sure you take care of your daughter. He exits the car in slow motion. And then she has these flashbacks, visions to her daughter smiling and like,
yeah.
At the window, I was like, what is this?
It just didn't make sense.
None of this movie made sense. It was awful. So now he goes back to Berlin. Oh, wait, no, hold on. Lost them? Oh, yeah. He meets up with his brother,
mm-hmm.
and they go to a restaurant. And there's three dudes watching him because his brother's trying to, lure him in so the CIA or FBI or whatever can, capture him. And he's like, he meets him at the restaurant and goes, hey, can we go somewhere where we could talk? And he's like, okay. They get up and walk away. The three dudes follow, check one room and go, ugh.
I know.
We lost them. They even make a phone call. They're like, oh, we lost them, boss. We're sorry. No effort. One room. They're like, oh, man, where could they have gone?
God.
So then they manage to get away and have a little chat. This is where he explained to his brother what the foreigner is.
Yeah.
So his brother's like, I need to know what they want you for, man. What's going on? And he explains to him the foreigner. And this, because the whole movie, I'm going, why is he a foreigner?
Yeah.
It's because he's an American in Poland. Okay, that makes sense. He has an American accent.
Mm-hmm.
But he was in deep cover, and then he basically got exiled. Yeah. There's a word for it. Crap. It's going to bug me. It doesn't matter. It'll come to me when I'm going to sleep tonight.
Yeah.
Ah, that's what it is. And he tells his brother everything. And then now he goes to meet Jared. He gets up on the roof, kills the sniper, because he's just the most amazing agent ever.
Mm-hmm.
Kills the sniper, and then goes down. They have a little chat, and then he shoots him as he's walking away.
Yeah, which is... And then the guy in the horse-drawn carriage doesn't hear it.
Because there's just not a lot of people outside in Warsaw. Everyone's just people on their horse-drawn carriage. So now he goes back to Berlin, because he's going to bust back into Van Aken.
I know, it's just bam, bam.
Van Aken's place. Dunois shows up all of a sudden. He's like, I knew I'd find you in Berlin. I'm like, oh my goodness.
Are you alive? Why?
How are you just here all of a sudden? So they sneak in, because they're like, two is better than one. We'll do it together, bro.
Yeah.
And he's like, once we're inside, then
we're on your own.
Yeah, so fuck you.
Yeah.
They break in. Dunois goes to kill him, and he's like, I knew you were going to do that. Took your bullets away. And then, what is he? He's like, you've already killed me twice. And he's like, well, you know what they say? Three's a charm.
Yeah.
No, they don't say three's a charm. They say third time's a charm.
Come on, Steven. Please.
Oh, he also, wait, hold on. No, even I jumped ahead. So they doubled security. Man, okay, hold on.
Yeah, from 2 to 4.
Yeah, because he meets Jerome here. Okay.
Oh, rat face.
They break in. He doesn't try to kill him yet. He meets Jerome. Jerome looks like a Nazi Ned Flanders. That's what he looked
he
like.
He does.
First thing I thought was this Nazi Ned Flanders right there. So they have a little back and forth. He kills Jerome. Does he kill Jerome?
Dubois kills Jerome when he comes in, and Jerome's like, wait out, they just have this at a mall.
That's right. But did you notice the shot? What was happening in the shot?
I thought they were setting it up because when Jerome was saying something, he was like, yes. Our problem will be handled by John now. And they were like panning out for once. I thought because they were in front of a mirror.
The seventh mirror shot of the movie.
Yeah, that it was going to be revealed that it was a fake mirror and was two-way glass and John was going to kill Dunois through it. But no.
No, what I was wondering is like literally the shot, his gun... It looks like he's holding a shotgun sideways. I watched it three times. But it's not like he goes to kill him, puts his arm up, should be holding
like,
a 9mm. But instead, it seriously looks like a shotgun sideways in his hand.
It does.
It's the oddest thing. And I was like, what? Something went wrong there.
Yeah.
What the hell? Because you don't see Buddy getting shot. You just see him pulling the trigger. I'm like,
and then he's like,
something's not right about this shot. And now we go back to Seagal wearing a different coat. So at one point, he obviously went home.
He's wearing his fuzzy brown coat.
How many coats did he bring with him?
A lot, I guess. It is Warsaw.
Man, that black leather coat he was wearing for the whole movie looked like it was doing a ton of work.
Yeah.
Because he looks out of shape. He got fat. Well, he's always been kind of fat.
He's been
squishy.
Sick.
So he goes to rescue the what's-her-face and their daughter. Because they're tied up. Breaks in. Nobody sees him. Gets in there and is like tying her up, untying her. She goes, behind you. And the guy behind him is like creeping up real slow. And he's like, even had like a smile on his face.
I know. He's like, I'm going to get you.
And Seagal's like, grabs the gun. Bam.
Like
his gun taking maneuvers in this were, if I was paying attention to the other people, they're getting the guns taken away because they'd be like, oh no. Twisting the arm up and then bam, they get shot. I go, the guy didn't resist at all. A normal person would be like, hey, get out of here, man.
Yeah.
Pull away from them.
It seemed like if I'm comparing this movie to a couple of the Van Damme ones I've seen, it seemed like this movie was trying way harder to make Steven Seagal come across as badass and an ultimate fighter and intense. Whereas Jean-Claude Van Damme, like he was just doing it.
Still use slow motion, but he was way more fun to watch. Seagal,
he takes himself too seriously.
Way too seriously.
Where Van Damme is like, I know I'm great at this, but I'm also a goofy little guy.
You know about Seagal's like cop show, right? He actually got like deputized or he's like became a sheriff and did a reality show where he was going around like being the law.
Like Dog the Bounty Hunter?
Kind of, but he would just pull people over. He was like, you have to look it up. It's like a straight up like A&E or TLC, Steven Seagal, I Am the Law show.
See, that's just indicative of him like trying to hold on so much to this like little power he once had as this top dog.
I'm pretty sure he's still making movies. Well, I don't know if he is now. I think he's in Russia, like hanging out with Putin. Yeah, he's weird. His life story. You should Google his story. It's very strange. I think he might be like in Russia because he's escaping some charges or something like that.
What
the
hell?
He may have like
hell?
Actually put somebody in the hospital doing some of his martial arts. Then now
he holds Serbian and Russian citizenship.
Oh, see, there you go.
Whoa.
Yeah, he's a Russian spy. This is where he kills. This is where he busts out the three's a charm.
Yeah.
Not third time is a charm. Kills Dunois.
Finally.
And then it's like, by this time, it's an hour and 32. This was an hour and 35 minutes. I was thinking the last 15 minutes is going to be credits.
Same.
Awesome. I was mad at this point.
Same.
Like, just
end it.
End it. And then it ended.
Just end me.
Oh, it ended with a voiceover of a letter from What's-Her-Face.
From Meredith.
Going like, thank you so much for helping me. Hope you have a great life. Later, and he's like on a boat going through a river. Then it's just like cast of characters. I'm like, oh,
okay.
That was the Foreigner, was not the Jackie Chan Foreigner.
Yeah, that was the regular bad one.
Would you real rate it?
Oh God, I real rated this one. Oh my God, what is it called? One silencer out of 10. Doobie, doobie doo, Dunois, death fake outs. Because the only thing I enjoyed about this movie was half a point for the weird techno rave fashion show. That was funny. So unnecessary, but I loved it so much. And then actually, I'm adjusting it. Half a point for the shot of the strangulation thing, because I did think that was cool. Quarter of a point for the techno rave fashion show. And then a quarter of a point for Meredith, because I did like her.
Mm-hmm.
She had a nice voice. She had a nice face. She was pleasant. I liked her.
I gave it 1.5 Nazi Ned Flanders out of 10 terrible henchmen. Because it made me, like, I was laughing. I was laughing hard because I love it when actors take themselves so seriously that it becomes comical. And Steven Seagal has done that throughout his career.
Mm-hmm.
And it just made me laugh. But oh my God, it was just dragging. It was long. I checked the time a dozen times.
Same.
Like, I just end it.
I jumped through like laughing at it to care anymore.
Woo, excuse me.
To I don't care anymore. I don't care anymore about this movie.
Yeah, that was The Foreigner. Don't watch it. I don't recommend it.
No,
anybody.
Don't. Take our word for it. We suffered.
We suffered for you. We
did it for You're welcome.
Find us on YouTube. Like and subscribe. Oh, I didn't say it at the start. I'm just going to add it in later.
Yeah.
Like and subscribe on YouTube. Follow us on wherever you're listening to this podcast.
Yeah.
Give us a rating on Apple. That might do something.
Yeah.
I was just thinking of random shit at work today. Keep fit and have fun. Drink lots of water. Go to bed early tonight. Stop staring at your phone.
Yeah.
Don't hit the snooze bar too many times.
Yeah.
Go for a walk. Turn your TV off for an hour and
do what my
yoga.
Sticker says. Hydrate and masturbate.
I need to go to the eye doctor. I've had fuzzy, blurry
fuzzy
vision
Leslie.
Already. It's just getting worse. Trying to see stuff far away. I'm like, I'm not even going to try. All right, everybody. That's been it. Bye.
Bye.
Real guys.